wilderness, but we will say yes to your wisdom, to your word, to your counsel, even to your rebuke. We bow to the authority of your speaking this morning, Father. We want to come boldly to your throne of grace to find help in times of need. And for many of us, this definitely is a time of need. And I thank you that your throne of grace meets us in a time of need. Thank you that the place on which you govern, your grace is a throne. It's government, it's rulership, it's authority. So we come boldly. Can we all repeat that? I come boldly to a throne filled with grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Just remind your neighbor, say, his throne is grace. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. And in your presence is the new wine and oil. And in your presence is where I long to be. Father, draw me near to where you are. Lift your hands in your presence. And in your presence, there is fullness of joy. In your presence is the new wine and oil. Your presence is where I long to be. Father, draw me near to where you are. For you are holy, so of joy. In your presence is the new wine and oil, and in your presence is where I long to be. Father, draw me lift your hand. You are holy. For you are holy, so holy, and I worship before you now. Lord, you are holy, so the draw me near to where you are. Father, draw me near to where you are. Just lift your hands to him. That's our prayer. That's our passion. Because if you don't draw, we cannot come. So we ask, like the Shunammite said, draw me and I will run to you. So we ask that you draw us. Come on, lift your hand and say, draw me, Father. Lure me. Draw me. Amen. Amen. Just greet someone and say, experience the drawing of the Lord this morning. Amen. Come on, just high five a few people and say, welcome, welcome, welcome.
Welcome, welcome.
Come on, clap your hands. Praying for the power of the Holy One, power of the Holy Spirit, power of the living.
Come on, to salvation.
Come on, clap your hands, all you people.
Bless the name of the Lord.
Shout to God with the voice of triumph. How many people say yes to the Spirit this morning? Amen.
Yes, Lord.
Come on, just high five a few people. Say yes to revival, yes to salvation, yes to breakthrough, yes to restoration. Amen. Hallelujah. The message on oneness came through very strongly yesterday, so we thought it appropriate to sing a song relative to that, but it's a prayer. It was a prayer of Jesus, and how many know the Father answers Jesus' prayers? The Son prayed to the Father, make them one. And I know God's going to answer that prayer in the midst of us. I want us to make a declarative statement, say, we are one. Amen.
We are one.
Make us one.
us one.
Come on, let's sing it. Let's pray it. Make us one.
Make us one.
Come on, lift those hands. Make it your prayer.
Make us one.
All across the aisles, if you would. You know, this is, as I've been saying, such a burden on my own heart. It must be more than a song. It must be a commitment. Everyone say it must be a commitment. I want to encourage us to just lift those hands, and this prophetic act of joining the hands is to solidify and consolidate the relational corporate oneness that I believe God has put his finger on, almost asked us to solidify and entrench. Let there be no divisions among us. We all speak the same thing. We all mind the same thing. Dave said something yesterday. There's nothing we cannot work out if it threatens relationships. Tell the neighbor next to you, there's nothing we cannot work out. Hallelujah. I want us to sing verse 1 in the chorus, but sing, we are one.
We are one.
By the power.
By the power of your spirit. We are one.
So your kingdom.
So your kingdom, Lord, your kingdom will come. We are one, Lord, we are one.
Sing it again. We are one. Make a statement.
We are one. We Spirit, we are one. So your kingdom, Lord, your kingdom will come. We are one, Lord, we are one.
So all may know.
So
guess, in fact, if you can hug everybody, do it. We'll take our time with this. I'm in absolutely no hurry this morning.
Make us one.
As we worship you.
Lift your hands, let his rain fall.
You know, there's an anointing for oneness. It's like the oil. How good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in oneness. It is like the oil. Everyone say it's like the oil. Oneness is equated to the anointing. Lift your hands. Let it fall on us. Come on, lift your voice. Let the oil of anointing for oneness fall on us. Let it fall, let it fall. We need your spirit, Lord. Let it rain. Let it rain. Just receive this morning.
Open the flood gates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the flood gates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it. Let it rain, oh Lord, let it rain.
Open the floodgates,
open the floodgates of heaven.
Let it rain,
let it rain,
let it rain, let it rain,
let it rain,
let it rain. To receive communion. Everyone say, this is the common union. It's our communion. Everyone say, one cup, one bread. Paul said that in Corinthians. For the cup, is it not the cup of blessing? One cup. The bread, is it not the one bread? One cup and one bread that we eat and drink. He died for this body, this mystical body called the Church of the Living God, his spiritual family. And as you prepare to receive his body and his blood this morning, receive grace for oneness. Everyone say grace for one body. Grace. Come on, say it. One bread, one cup. Say it with me loud. We are one. Come on, declare it. Just say, we are one. In the name of the Lord. Receive his body and receive the blood of the Lord. Amen. While you stand, we're going to receive the offering. And I want to encourage you to give liberally as unto the Lord. All our giving is going towards an expression of honor to Dave and Maurice for imparting the grace of Christ to our community. Amen. How many believe God is in the restoration business? Amen. Amen. And I will restore. I will restore. I will restore to you all of this and more. I will restore. I will restore. I will restore to you all of this and more. I will restore to you all of this and more. Let's sing verse 1. What was lost? Sing. What was lost in battle? What was taken unlawful? Where the enemy has planted his seed? And where health is ailing and where strength is failing, I will restore to you all of this and more. I will restore to you all of this. Come on, that's God's word to us. Lift your hands and sing. I will restore. I will restore. I will restore to you all of this and more.
Your hands, sing your
Your Spirit lives within me, so I will walk in Your peace. Your Spirit lives within me, my victory, Your Spirit lives within me, so I will walk in Your peace. Your Spirit lives within me. Come on, my victory. Receive his assurance that all will be well. Come on, say like the Shunammite, tell your neighbor, all will be well. Come on, say it will be well. When Elisha asked her, or the servant of Elisha, how is it with you, your husband and your son? She said, it is well. Come on, say it again, it is well.
It is well.
Say, especially if your son name is Barnwell. You may be seated. God bless you.
Good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome to the house. I feel when Marie said yesterday, it's like the horse at the gate, that's the gate opens and you just push forward, there's a finish. You have the blinkers on, you're not looking to your left, you aren't looking to your right, you're just forging ahead. And I see even on your expressions today that the gate was open yesterday and you're still running because it ain't finished yet. Dave is going to still share with us God's heart today. And I felt so, I couldn't sleep last night. I was telling them, I slept at 2:30 and I woke up at 5. So I had 2.5 sleeping because there's just excitement in my bones, in my sinews, in every fiber of my body, because God is indeed speaking to us. And I'm sure you will agree about the profound speaking of the Lord, even through the servants of God, Dave. And so ready your hearts to receive what God has in store for you. A warm welcome to the house. But also welcome to our visitors who's here for the first time, Duran Pillay. If you can stand up so we can give you a warm welcome. Let's welcome Duran. Welcome. Remember, this is your father's house, so we are family. We are the family of God. And then Stephen and Kim Steinbank. Stephen and Kim, welcome. They came with Nikki Lola. Welcome. So good to have you. It's your father's house. Feel free, relax. God has a word for you today. Amen. And then Dawn Anderson, Auntie Rita's baby sister. Welcome, Dawn. Good to have you with us. Good to have you with us. And then these are no visitors. These are family. Nolan, Debbie, and Kiana. If you can stand, a warm welcome. warm welcome. And then we have Auntie Davina. If Auntie Davina can stand, welcome Auntie Davina. And for those of you who know, about 3 to 4 weeks ago, Uncle Basil was taken to be with the Lord, Auntie Davina's husband. And we know that God's grace and has been your strength and your stay and your undergirding. And so we just want you to know, Auntie Davina, that although you fellowship in another house, we are here for you as Gate Ministries, Durban Central. Randolph and I are just a call away because you are part of us. You are part of our hearts. And so we bless you today. Our hearts are also with Jeremy's family. Jeremy lost his grandma. And so they in Pochepston, the funeral is today. So our hearts are with them even right now. Nadine lost a loved one. Our hearts are with Nadine and her family. And Andre van Skalvik, there's Andre there. Welcome, Andre. Is Emma and the rest of the family here? Did your parents come to Durban? Not yet. Well, the day that the parents were relocating to stay with Andre because of they're in an area that's riddled with violence and gangsterism, on the morning they were going to leave, Andre's dad was shot with a stray bullet. But we thank God that it was not fatal. God's hand was there. So we're still worshiping God for that. You know, there's still something to worship God for. God preserved his life, so they weren't able to come on that day. So many things, there's been deaths, there's been shootings, there's been so much that's been happening, but we refuse to be derailed. God's purposes will prevail. God's will prevail. God speaking, it's still real, it's still here. And we know that those families who long to be here, like Marie said yesterday, that when they hear messages afterwards on YouTube, that it may just be one word that God needed for them to fill that deficiency in them, they will get double portion. And so we speak that into that, and just remember them in your prayers today. And so a special welcome. They know they put their family as well. They're not visitors. Maurice and Dave, all the way from Trinidad. I know Randolph gave an extensive introduction yesterday, but we are so privileged, Randolph and I, to have them in our home. So we got that grace impartation, not just over here. We take it back home. And so we feel so honored and privileged to house the servants of the Lord. So grace to you and peace to you. And then the birthdays for the week. Before I get to the birthdays, on Wednesday evening at 7 is our Zoom meeting. It's a prophetic review meeting. So we know that God has been really speaking profoundly to each one of us, uniquely. This word, we're going to cut it into pieces so that it's assimilated by even the Sunday school child. So that is, you know, when you eat something, your gastric juices help with your digestion. So Wednesday is like a gastric juice meeting, you know. We're going to help with the assimilation, the breaking down the digestion, and we know that grace. Amen. And then Saturday morning at 7:15 to 8 is our usual prayer meeting. We know that God's been doing amazing things in those meetings. Thank you to those who prayed the whole week from 5:30 to 6. It was the most attendance ever. And we know that you're going to be fueled up even for Saturday. The house has indeed shifted to the next level. We feel it in the teachings the last 3 months on resurrection power. There are testimonies budding all over about God's goodness, not just on physical healing, emotional healing, but salary increases, promotions, jobs. Like on every level, we're just seeing the manifestation of God's word being made manifest in our lives. And so open your hearts. God has something. Nobody's going to leave with saying, I received nothing. Each one from the smallest to the oldest, God has something in store for you. There won't be children's church today. The children will sit in. And birthdays for the week was Matthew in Cape Town and Akira there at the back. We wish you, we trust you had a wonderful day. And also wedding anniversaries, Errol and Esther, happy anniversary. We just bless you today and we pray that great grace may be your portion and that the will of God will be, that the journey ahead and the path ahead will be purpose loaded and purpose driven. Amen. Is there anything I left out? Oh, one more thing. We just want to acknowledge the house and say thank you to the hospitality team that worked so beautifully. There was such a spirit of oneness. the hospitality team, the worship team, the ushering team. And if you weren't in any team, you're a son of the house. Your presence was strategic. We saw you helping. We saw you greet the people and hug the people. So each one of you played a strategic part. And Randolph and I want to acknowledge you and thank you. We always say that this is God's house. This house is not Randolph and I's house. God is building his house. He's just asked us to steward the building process in this corner of the body of Christ. And we cannot do it alone. Each one of you are part of the building process. You are all tools, like we are just instruments in God's hand. So we cannot build it alone. And we feel the strength of the house. We feel the love and support. And we feel like, you know, the Aaron and her holding up Moses' hand. So we want to thank you. We bless you. We honor you. And we know that the regard of the Lord is on you. So while we express thanks in the natural, the heavenly's regard and what you sow, we know there's always a bounty for reaping. So with that, hand over to my handsome hubby, Randy.
Thank you, my beautiful wife. Amen. I just also want to acknowledge Renee. She has been the engine behind most teams. And she saw to all the registration, all the names were fed to her. It was a constant checking the phone, updating the book, etc., and checking with the leaders of each of the teams on a consistent basis as to their preparedness. So thank you, Ren, for your diligence. Incredibly strong woman of God, this. She bears a lot. She has massive shoulders. And so let's just give Renee a hand of honor and thank you. Amen. For all that she has done. I think just one announcement. Next week, Sunday, there is no physical meeting here in this venue, simply because the entire varsity is having a major conference, a weekend conference. And these facilities are all being occupied next week, Sunday morning. So next week, Sunday morning, we're going to meet online via Zoom. Amen. At the usual, from 9 until about 9:15, 9:30, we should be done. So in the week, please note that on Wednesday is a prophetic review meeting where we will go over some of the imperatives that were released at the conference. And I want to encourage you all to come. May I please appeal to you to put your videos on? It is strange talking to people's names. You know, you see a person's name. What helps me is maybe 3 or 4 that got their cameras on and I'm addressing. I can at least see some reaction. It really helps the person speaking. It demands, though, that you prepare for the meeting. You cannot wake up at 5 to 9 and come on Zoom at 9 because, in fact, I think online meetings demand far more preparation than physical meetings. To come here physically, you would take an hour before to prepare adequately. But online equally demands an honor that you bestow upon the meeting. And I'm not saying camera is indicative of honor, but I just think it will add to the sense of oneness and fellowship and harmony. So please look out for the notification in reference to that next week. My heart is so full. Is your heart full? Amen. God has been pouring into us since the start of the conference. And I want to thank God for Dave and for Maurice. We got to know them. Last night we played a game of sequence. We taught them sequence, the game. Amen. And we put aside all spiritual protocol and spiritual principle. And we tried to outdo each other. Amen. But it was a great time of just seeing other sides to them. These are normal people. Everyone say they're normal human beings. But the normality of a person changes when that person stands in office. And the Jacob becomes the Israel. And there's a grace. You must always discern to breaking the familiar man that you know to when that man steps into his grace. He doesn't speak as a man anymore. He then speaks as the one sent from heaven. And we've got to make that transition mentally, because what and how we hear determine how we obey. And if you're hearing amen, you can very easily dismiss what he says. But when you hear God in the man, it's a different story altogether. Amen. And so we did all the introductions yesterday. I just want to thank God for this couple. Like I said, in COVID, it was where I got to know David. I listened to one of his presentations in a prophetic, 10-week prophetic program that I was a part of. And subsequently, a few weeks or months later, a close friend to both of us was ill, a minister of Christ with COVID. And he felt the need to encourage this minister every single day. For about 5 days, I think, the week we went. And we met via Zoom. So I was in South Africa, he's in Trini, and the other guy was in Mauritius, and we're busy encouraging a brother. When he says love practically, I've seen it work. I've seen how he took deliberate steps to reach out to a brother and to encourage him in Christ. Amen. Pump someone and say, take the initiative. Take the initiative. Take deliberate steps. Amen. And so I'm so glad that the message and the messenger have become one. Amen. So I want you to stand as we receive a one sent from above. It's not a man on the earth. It's a man that steps into office. And we want to say, Dave, that we are entirely submitted to the words released today. So please feel absolutely free. Let's say, blessed is he. Blessed is he who comes. In the name of the Lord.
Amen. A little messed up right now. A good way. Very good way. There's a tough one this morning. Tough one for me. But you can hear me good? I'm going to do something that I don't normally do because I heard the Lord speak to me while I was sitting right there. Come, please. Look at the people. So this morning I'm before the Lord and he switched up my message. Amen. Amen. And when he switches things up and he puts the word of confirmation in the mouth of the leaders just before I come up to speak, that completely changes the level of the weight of what is about to be delivered. You all understand what I'm saying? Pastor Rennie said, God is building his house. Remember when she said that? And I'm sitting down there, and that's what I'm about to talk about. And I literally felt the Lord say, there's a prophetic capacity on your life that needs to go to the next level. This thing is dropping in and out. Come help me out. And I just want us to take this time, stand in agreement with what the Lord wants to least upon our life right now. There's a capacity of what's in me, that's for you. This is real saints. This is no joke. This is payload. Everybody say payload. You're delivering ammunition to the battlefield, capacity that is going to be released, and I'm going to talk about some of this stuff today, but it is necessary for this to happen right now. So Father God, I just lay my hands upon my sister even right now. And I just release that which is on me in her life. Father God, by the authority that you have given, I just declare, cause the favor of God to come upon her in a brand new way. Release your prophetic capacity. Stir that gift. Cause a release, a release, a release, and a weight, and a weight, and a weight to come upon her life. Father God, we thank you for what you're going to do. God, I declare that her life shall never remain the same. Cause our ears to be open and cause our heart to be exploded with your love. Cause our declarations to bring transformation and change and release to the lives of those that she will touch in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Shabosh kerebe seke. Oh God, we honor you. Shabosh karabaseke. We release it, oh God, into our life. And we thank you, Lord God, that our life will never remain the same. Saints, let's agree with us. Let's just agree and just give God thanks. Father, we honor you. We give you praise. We thank you for divine deposits, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for configuring this house according to your design. Oh, there's such an anointing in this place. Hallelujah. Oh, praise your name. We call to be a house of wisdom. A house of wisdom. We are called to be a house of wisdom. Everybody say wisdom. I'm just honored to be in your company, to observe and to see the patterns of just truth. Oh my God, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. I am completely missed. Help me. I have seen patterns on the inside of this church that needs to be exported globally. Hear my heart. And cultivated here is designed to be replicated. Say replicated. And administrated. Say administrated. That means that the responsibility for stewardship of what God has deposited in the house is important. It is very important. We all play a part in administrating the grace that rests on this house. And there's a design, there's a unique design. There's a unique configuration. There's something that is gate. Thank God for identity, uniqueness, and that which he has placed in us. What God is doing here is what he is doing here. The word for this house is the word for this house. Everybody say this house. That's right. There you go. As we continue to co-labor with God, you see, in the building of his ecclesia, say ecclesia. That's the fancy Hebrew word, Greek word for church. So that we've heard this 1,000 times. Ecclesia, governors, ambassadors, we must entertain, we must be certain. I am messed up. You all trust me on this one. We must be certain that the building strategy remains guided by the principles founded on the house of wisdom that remains in opposition to that which governs the house of folly. There are two houses that are at work all the time. Foolishness, prevalent. There are houses of folly that exist in the earth. There are patterns and principles that mock our true identity, that take away our effectiveness and compromise our stance and our mandate that has been given to us by God. Those are houses of folly. And there's an ongoing threat by the enemy to influence us in patterns of folly and rob us of our true identity to be houses of wisdom. See, we are our house of wisdom. And I want this phrase to become part of the speech, part of the understanding of what is set in Scripture, what is ascribed in the Word, which is an eternal truth that cannot change. This is not made up stuff. This is God's Word. Jesus is the Word of God made flesh. So when we talk about the Word of God, we are not talking about information. We are talking about a person. And the Word is light, life. It gives us strength to function, to see, to operate. In him we live, move, and we have our being. That's the Word. And we live for his Word. And we don't depart from his Word. Amen? We are the house of God. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Living stones. Every stone is alive in this building. We're not dead stones. We're active. We're mobile. Everything that is alive grows. Everybody say growth. You cannot be alive and not grow. We're living stones. We're growing. We're evolving. We're becoming. We're journeying towards where God wants us to be together. We collectively make the house. And our lives together matter. Living stones, not just as individual stones, but as a corporate collection of what God is doing. Your life's experience, your challenges interact next to mine. The life that is in you is built alongside the life that is in me. We are living stones together. Everybody say together. This is critical. Because the identity prescribed in Scripture in Proverbs 9, 1 to 18, talks to our reality and our unique design. And we're going to get right into it. The principles regarding the process of our building apply to us, and the blueprint for becoming a house of wisdom will be explored in great detail. So I want us to take personal notes, listen to what God is saying, and let's look at today's word as a blueprint, as a template. I believe that this word is not just speaking to Gate Durban, but Gate in general. Because the identity of what God is building is across the board, all of Gate's ministry. So I'd like to say a special welcome and hello, and thank you for joining those that are online. Those that are looking, listening, I pray that there'd be an interconnectedness of this message that goes across the board. That the defining nature of this word will change the configuration and sharpen the accuracy of what God is building in this house. This is a fun word. Everybody say fun word. This one not heavy. It's not as challenging as yesterday. So we can lighten up. We can loosen up a little bit. Put a smile on. Nobody's getting rebuked. We're going to be encouraged today. All right? So I'm up 2-3 in the morning and God is talking and I'm happy. Without coffee. I'm good. And I'm really excited because what's here is genuine. Y'all are really, really, really blessed. What is being built in this house is real. This is good stuff. I stepped into something that is already authentic. I didn't come to create anything authentic. I just came to bring some payload, a little munition, some ammunition, you know, put it in your holster, have it ready. I want us to shine in this environment. There's a shine that God wants to put upon us collectively. That as we represent him in this environment, change is going to come. This word has an excitement built into it that I believe God wants to release into every heart. Because it is a directional word that has taken us to where we need to go. And we will all see it. We'll all see it. So let's jump right in. The Proverbs were written by the wisest man of all that built a house unlike any other that was built. You all know this. His father gathered materials for years. I'm talking about the materials that built the house that Solomon built. It's unsurpassed by all houses that have been ever built. Then God said to him, because you have asked this thing, and have not asked for long life for yourself. Everybody say yourself. Nor have you asked for riches for yourself. Say yourself. Nor have you asked for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself the understanding to discern justice. There's a focus that informed the technology for building the house in Solomon's time that had nothing to do with personal self-aggrandizement. This was not for self-gain. Solomon saw that if my focus was not on myself, God was going to pour in even what I didn't even ask for. Listen, that's who we're becoming. We're becoming a corporate house that's focused on bringing transformation and change and redemption to our environment. And because our focus is for the people, God is going to pour in wisdom and capacity and resources that we have not even asked for. Amen? Because the resources are there to facilitate the reaching of people. Come on, say amen. That's real. Because what God did in Solomon, he was like, you didn't look for stuff for you. I'm going to look for stuff for you because you were not looking after you.
Behold, I have done according to your word. See, I have given you a wise and understanding heart so that there is not, has not been anyone like you before, nor shall there be anyone like you after. Everybody say, blueprint. That's it right there. I'm going to do something that I don't normally do. I'm going to make you unique. Nobody was like you, and there ain't going to be anybody else like you after that. Because the patterns of truth that are going to live in you will last forever. It's an eternal work that God did in establishing the patterns of Solomon's life. So his insight, his wisdom, the capacity that lived on the inside, are inscribed in his words. I live in Proverbs and I live in Psalms. These guys understood stuff that nobody else understood in their generation. Do you know what it would be like if the actual king, actual boss of South Africa, man at the top, had the capacity to think on a level like no one else has the capacity to think, that has wisdom that surpassed every other president, prime minister, king before or after? What would that nation look like if it was led by a king that had that level of capacity? It would be an unsurpassed nation. It would represent prototypes that every other nation would need to come sit and learn from. And that's exactly what happened with Solomon. Don't remember Sheba? Showed up. Let's get into this some more. The wisdom of God transcended far beyond that which is spoken in words. It translated into demonstrated, operationalized functionality that could be seen by all. Demonstrated, operationalized functionality that could be seen by all. And when the Queen of Sheba had seen, everybody say seen, all the wisdom of Solomon and the house that he had built. Listen, Sheba visited and she saw something that exceeded what she heard. What you heard, what was told, what was captured by words was enough to initiate a journey, a voyage, a visitation with gifts, abundance of gifts, based with expectation and regard for what God was doing in the house. But when she arrived, what she saw is what the scripture said. It far outweighed everything that she had thought based on what she saw. So this thing was on another level in person. When she moved from what she heard and came into contact with what she encountered firsthand, it was like, wow, I didn't even expect all of this. So there's something about what happens by the reputation that God builds on the outside that's on another level when it's observed on the inside. That's the Queen Sheba dynamic that we believe in God for. Amen? That when they come alongside to look in and to observe, we're going to see stuff that we never even heard about. You're going to see patterns of behavior, order, respect, honor, love, forgiveness at work to such a degree that you're going to be like, wow, this thing lives? I've never seen a house built like that. That's this house. So get ready for visitors based on the reputation that goes outside of the walls of this house. Get ready for onlookers that would come and say, the half has not been told. As we get into the groups on Wednesday, I want us to study that scripture, 1 Kings, that talks about Sheba's visit. I don't have the time to go into all the details, but it's loaded with stuff that's directly applicable to exactly what is going to happen when people come to this house. Because they're not just going to come empty-handed. As we journey to the place that God is building us, people are not going to come empty-handed to this house. They're going to come with value. Everybody say value. Because the value is necessary to sustain the advance, the growth, and the development of what God has deposited in the house. Amen? Hey, let's go. Proverbs 1. Wisdom has built a house. She has hewn out her seven pillars. Wisdom, Proverbs 9 verse 1. Wisdom has built a house. She has hewn out, cut out, her seven pillars. Yesterday we were talking about we are timber. Amen? The house of wisdom is built, say built, by the Lord himself according to a clearly called set of leaders that define the structure and enables the stability of the unique vision. Listen to me and listen to me well. That's what God is building. A house that has been hewn out. Seven pillars have been cut out. It must be noted that these structures have a plural or complete leadership, which is necessary for balance, and it's never designed for a one-man show to take all of the weight. Seven pillars, the seven pillar principle defines the structural wisdom of the house. There's a collection of leadership that God has set in the house to allow the weight to be carried and distributed. That's wisdom. This is not a one-man show. God has not built a one-family show. So when the elders and the senior elders appoint leaders to function in certain capacities, it is because this is the biblical design. There are seven carved out pillars that need to carry the load. Seven represents completeness, a complete set of leadership. Amen? It's not a one-man show. And the houses of folly do not understand this. The houses of wisdom understand that God is interested in plural leadership. And we need to understand that that means that among us, we need to step up and take the weight as well. Because leadership is not a title, it's a function. It's work. And it's not work that we sit back and we leave to the leaders to do. This is Proverbs 9, number 1. This is where it starts. And whenever God mentions a thing first, it is critical for us to understand that first things are first. The issues of leadership are clearly defined as a standard for how people observe our internal structure. We are people of seven pillars. Say seven pillars. Complete leadership. Balance. Balance. So we have a leadership meeting and we're talking about stuff and man of God says, well, I really think that we need to go left. Somebody says, Pastor, with all due respect, I think we're right. Do you know that the scripture says submit one to another? And submission has to do with the collective, we have the mind of Christ. God has charged him with the responsibility of leading, but he has also charged him, and listen to this, with the responsibility of listening. Plural leadership allows the voice of God to be heard more clearly and insulates us from being derailed so that God would surround him with the necessary pillars that are required to carry the load. Everybody say carry the load together. This is serious stuff right here. But we understand that when God sets pillars in the house, that we need to honor those pillars. Because they are necessary for us to go where God wants us to go. Don't just pull back and say, well, we leave it all up to them. That's not the design. That's the first principle. I didn't create this. Wisdom has built a house. She, and she is the Lord in this context, because wisdom is the one building a house. God is the one building a house. That's the word that we heard this morning. And the first thing that God is doing is he's establishing the leadership. Listen, a house without clear leadership is problems, you know. And we have that here. We have that here. Everybody say we have that. And we have good leaders too. So for those that would come, you know what's the first thing they see when they walk into the house? Pillars. Pillars are visible. Pillars you see standing upright, they're in your face. All those people who run from leadership and want to hide, oh my God, I don't want nobody to see me. That's not the heart of a leader. You don't take a light and put it where? Under. Allow visibility of the rightness of God to be part of who we are. Amen? You don't want Sheba coming to visit and looking for the leaders. Where the leaders were? You don't want that. Everybody say seven pillars. Amen. Over. Two. Sending houses are designed and built by the Lord from clear plans, vision, predefined mandates, and deliberate structure according to God's architecture. Say God's architecture. They stand on people pillars of fivefold graces called to reside within the house. So within this place, God is going to raise up fivefold pillars. That's our design. They give definition to the shape and train the internal capacity and the unique nature of the house. That's who we are. Our house has seven pillars. Complete leadership. Give us and equip us in all aspects of who Christ is in his full fivefold dimension. We're not leaving any out. I'm going to
see that in scripture just now. Y'all ready for two? Proverbs 9:2. Now remember, wisdom is the one that's building the house, right? And we are a house of wisdom. And God is building us. So this is our identity. This is our makeup. This is two. She has slaughtered her meat. She has mixed her wine. Anybody drink wine here? Get quiet, boy. She has also furnished her table. Now watch this. The house of wisdom serves with preparation and functions from a diet of sustenance for the mature. Everybody say mature. This is a house of meat. We are not a milk house. We are not a house of babes. In order for us to have the representation that blew Sheba's mind, we have to be people that grew up on a strong diet. The table of this house is one of meat. Everybody say meat. But you know, even beyond meat, she has mixed her wine. And they produce a unique mixture of spiritual giftings to serve those that dwell therein. Wine talks spiritual gifting. We sang about new wine this morning. Now, when you're talking about she has mixed new wine, we're talking about a mixture of spiritual giftings. We're talking about recognizing that on this table, what is accessed in this house, what is served, are the giftings of those that God has called in this house to serve from the table. There are giftings of prophecy and giftings of evangelistic work and all different types of spiritual giftings that reside in the house that form a unique mixture. Say mixture. Everybody needs to understand that God has given gifts to everyone. The house is filled with what? Mixed wine. She has mixed her wine. And we are all part of the table that God is serving. This is not just for the pastor, the apostle, the bishop. Online, I know we have some bishops out there. But this is the function and the call that rests on each and every one of us. There are spiritual giftings that need to be mixed together right. We need to strategize how we serve and administrate the gifts based on how we combine ministries together. So let's say we have an entrepreneur and we have somebody with a prophetic capacity. We put those two together and we send them out and we say, here's what's happening. Go into the marketplace and infiltrate and release the prophetic word into the business. We've mixed wine. We've put it on the table. We say those that have an evangelistic capacity and those that have reached into the health sector, while we're out there on the front lines administrating needles, we're saying God loves you. And what we're doing is that we are serving mixed wine. Everybody say mixed wine. So we are taking the giftings that God has placed on the inside and we are practically administrating it to our environment. That's what we have on the table. But here's what is beautiful about this. Here's what it says. She has also furnished her table. Watch what it speaks. They systematically arrange and they arrange with order the diverse ministry of the word. Let me talk about this a little bit. That word, furnished, speaks to order. It speaks to a unique placement. You know when people coming over to your house, you fix the table real nice, a little flower in the middle, napkin, with your knife on which side? Left. knife is on your right. The fork is on the left. So there's a specific order. And don't put it out of order. The table is furnished with order. Everybody say order. And as the table is set, God is going to take some arrangement and rearrangement. But what we declare is when the table is set, that we are set in order. That we are properly placed. And we need to trust leadership to set us right in the right order in order for us to be able to serve those that would come. This is what Solomon understood. This is what the king understood. This is what was observed by Queen Sheba, that when she saw in the natural, there were spiritual principles locked in there that define our reality for today. Everybody, finish the table. See it? That's order. Placement. If anybody in this house feels out of place, that's the time to reach out to leadership and say, help me to find my unique place where I need to function in this house. Because everybody needs to be put in the right place, in the right order, on the table. There's nobody's place that is under the table. Amen? We can't eat under the table. The mixed wine is served where? On top the table. And trust me, I know the culture of gate people. We love tables. Oh, had dinner with Pastor Tamo. We need so much. But divine order is part of what God is going to do. He's going to arrange us properly. He's going to set everybody where they need to be. Nobody's going to be out of place. Everybody's going to be rightly positioned. Everybody say rightly positioned. Oh, hallelujah. This is only verse 2, you know. I have more verses. Understanding the nature of this word is very, very specific and very deliberate. It's almost like as I was seeing this stuff, God is saying, explain the clarity with which we can follow in this. So this is like an instructions manual and deliberate steps that God has laid out. That there's going to be a season of everybody being set right on the table. Every single person, every department of this church that has a place that God has prescribed, every single one of us, from the greatest to the least, the youngest, the oldest, which I absolutely respect and love, that we honor everyone on the table. That when we look at the young ones, who's the youngest person in this building? Where's the baby? Where's the baby? Release some grace on the baby. Hallelujah. Baby name? Keon? Everybody just agree with me. Keon, arise and fulfill your destiny. Thank you for your life. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for divine arrangement and proper configuration. Release full health to this baby right now, and rebuke the enemy, the devourer. And we say that shall arise, shine, grace that God has called him. Amen. Everybody say amen. Amen. Babies, we like babies. Every single one of us, properly arranged, systematic arrangement, divine placement, order. Let's go to 3. The house of wisdom understands the proper timing of its operation. Listen to this one. The preparation of the table must precede the sending of the servants, and the servants are trained in the prophetic frequency or diet of the house for their sent. Table laid. Table set. Everything is placed in order. Next slide.
she has sent out her maidens. And she cries out from the highest places of the city. Oh, we love that word sent. We know it. We know it by heart. That word sent is who we are. That's gate. We are a sent house. But we're going to talk a little bit about that. We're going to get into some of the details. The house of wisdom understands the importance of prophetic training and apostolic sending for the young in the house. Now, I want you all to work with me here. You see that word maidens? Maiden speaks to young women in the literal context. Its wider context is to the young in general. So the sending that's built into the wisdom in terms of how the house is configured, here's what it means. It means that to be in this house as a young person, and young means young in the faith. It has nothing to do with chronological age. It has to mean as you step into your journey in Christ, those are the maidens we are talking about. That there is a sending that's upon them. Now, we traditionally used to think that the way in which we build church is we wait for the apostles. The men of God, he goes to the nation. Hallelujah. Let's take an offering. Right? And we've seen this pattern for generations. Listen, house of folly. Let me tell you all something. Watch the strategy. This is the biblical wisdom that Solomon carried in the house. If you take the young ones and you train them from early as you arrive and you begin sending them out from early, here's what happens. It ensures that the culture of laziness is broken. The continued systematic expansion through evangelism occurs and an early maturation of the family is part of its culture. We break that down. So we are part of the house, and as we arrive, we are put to work. We are properly organized so that you don't come to sit and get fat and enjoy the worship while those on the outside are starving. You come into this house, you are divinely placed, you are divinely located, you are trained. You get the prophetic frequency of the house. You get the apostolic mandate that comes to you, and you get sent back out one time. Because the value that you have received in the house is designed for the city. She cries out from the highest places of the city. Now, I took the time, my host took the time to drive me around the city. I'm actually very interested in the city. So I went and I looked and I saw. And I saw the buildings. And I saw the people on the streets. And I saw the common man walking around. And I saw the nice buildings and I saw the beautiful beaches. And I saw the diversity of the society that exists in this space. And I say, Lord, where are the sent ones? Where are those that understand the mandate, the frequency, to go to these places and touch it? Where are the surfer boys that could go hang out on the beach and release grace into that environment? Where are the people from the marketplaces that could step into offices and say, hey, let me show you a better value? That's who we are. Listen, she cries out from the highest places of the what? She's not homebound. That's the wisdom of the house. The wisdom of the house is that that which God is designing is not just to stay inside of this building and enjoy this wonderful experience and enjoy our wonderful placement. Listen, there are people hungry out there.
got people starving out there. But God has appointed a strategy and a system to fix it. You know this system? Us. Our divine arrangement and our equipping is to serve the need of our environment and to bring transformation to it. That's why we have been built. And that's what makes us wise. We are wise because what God has configured can be distributed. Everybody say distributed. And we all form a part of exactly how God is arranging life in the city, because the city is us. We don't live apart from the city. The city is crying out for us. The city is saying, "Where are you?" And our response is, "Here we are." Listen, it's work, you know. It's fun. Because we're not going out empty-handed. We're not equipped. Mixed wine. We're going to lay hands on people today and release all kind of capacity. Listen, as I walk to the front, I heard the Lord say, "Put it on her. Start at the top. Release grace so that when we function in the city," transformation. Everybody say transformation. Here's what it says. "The bold representation is established outside of the walls of the house, and access to the grace of the house." So we take the grace of the house and we carry it out. So we bring the access to them. "We do not wait for them to come to us." That's a long time, church. We don't come and figure out wonderful life here and say, "All right, everybody." We will see very shortly that that is the strategy of the house of folly. And many churches have walked in that strategy. But that's not it. This pattern is not even new. The minute Jesus got on the scene and he appointed his 12, he didn't take 20 years to train them. He said, "Listen, receive it and head out one time. Learn on the job." Y'all know that that's in scripture. When Jesus appointed the 12, he took the spirit that was on him, he placed it on them, and he sent them out. And they came back and reported, "Wow, the evil spirits are subject unto us. I never knew this was possible for a young person, for young in the faith, for a maiden." The template of that functionality has existed from the beginning. So we need to reorganize our thinking as members of the house to say, "Listen, I have a part to play in the dissemination of grace that God has poured into this." Come on, y'all. Smile. It's not so bad. It's going to get exciting. So there am I in Johannesburg, and we're in this restaurant. And this young guy is serving us in the restaurant. And I get a word for him. And I said, "How can I pray with you?" And I began to release the word. And he's like, "Oh my God, just today, I was walking to work and I felt that I needed to do this, blah, blah, blah." He went away with something to bring alignment to his way, to his direction. I was just in the restaurant, just doing my stuff. Then we went somewhere else. Where do we go? We go to another restaurant to eat some Indian food. Good Indian food. Spicy stuff, but right? And the lady that's serving us, what was her name? Princess. And I could see her face glowing. I was like, "Look at this, my God. Tough on her life." And I'm sitting at the table and I'm like, "We need to minister to Princess." So I said, "Maurice, can you please just pray with Princess?" And she zaps her. And we all on this table and we agree. And she's there. "Can we pray?" "Of course." And she said, "Zap, zap, 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 zap."
A co-worker is on looking. And she walks by after the prayer and says, I receive it. Yeah. And I'm there and I'm walking away from this thing stunned. Right? I didn't even pray, right? And while we are walking to the car, another lady walks up with a dog. Sir, please, can you pray for me too? I'm like, oh my God. We just dared to step out and take one leap, and the city began to respond. Life began to flow. The maidens were sent out, and there was a response immediately. So what I'm telling you is no joke. It's not guess. This thing is ripe. This thing is ready. Durban is ready for this. And it's simple because we have it in us. I saw it happen. I'm telling you, I'm eating my curry. And God is talking to me about this lady. And I'm like, I didn't even get to minister to her. But the thing just went out. Everywhere we go, we were in some other restaurant, some other place. And this young guy who's serving us, on my heart, I was like, my God, can I pray with you? He said, yes. Nobody said no to prayer. Nobody said, oh, I don't want this. And I'm there and I'm saying, the fields are ripe and ready for harvest. So this is a good time. Everybody say a good time. It's a good time. This is real. This is good stuff. We're going to get out there and we're going to touch the environment. We're going to touch the city. But let's take it up a notch because we're going to talk a little bit more strategy. This is just verse 3, you know. I don't even know how much time I have. How much time I have? Oh, yeah, man. Plenty time. Next slide. Y'all good? Everybody receiving something? This is in scripture. We go back and we study it for ourselves. And we just allow God to minister this to our hearts one-on-one. Amen? The house of wisdom carries a distinct operational strategy for the city. It is a sending house that engages, impacts, and accesses the high strategic places of the city. Everybody say high and strategic. Let me give you all a little tidbit right there about high and strategic. And this is something that I live. And there may be a couple of my guys online that's listening. I play golf. In my life, years ago. And you know why? Do you know who golfs? High strategic people golf. Listen to me well. High strategic people play golf. I golf. I'm actually not so bad. I'm not great, but I'm not so bad. I can hold my own. I was able to golf here when I was in Johannesburg. Had a wonderful time. But I'm just going to see the principle in our function and our operational understanding about talking about high strategic places. Wisdom in how the house is built is very clear that we're after the high strategic places. Because things that are changed from the top affect the whole. Things that are done on high trickle down below. That's why laws are important. That's why there's talk about the seven mountains. That's an existence of things that happen from high places. High places regulate low places. Leadership impacts on the nature and the culture of organizations. Touching leaders is something that we grace to do in this house. So I prophesy a season of seminars to this church. Seminars. Say into the environment, we are here for you to teach you stuff. Businessmen, we're here for you. Come, let's talk. Let's have coffee and tea. Yeah? Let's do seminars for the region. Let's collect our resources strategically in different sectors. Let's arrange ourselves. And let's speak to the environment. Let's talk to the high places. Let's not be afraid of the high places. Let's not just leave rich people to stay in the high places. And by the way, high has nothing to do with money. Yeah? High just has to do with relevance. Relevance to criticality. That's what high is. There are many sectors, and we all know the seven mountains, and we all know the different areas. But you know what are the high places that I like? Entertainment. Who here on TikTok? Young people. All the TikTokers. Yeah. That's a high place right there, you know. That's a place for inference. I'm on Instagram. You find me on the gram. And I actually influence on the gram. And here's how I influence on the gram. And I'm being practical here. And I want you all to understand that this is not theoretical. This is real, practical. Here's how I actually influence on the gram. So I have this business, a woodworking business. I actually do woodworking stuff. I build stuff with my hands. I have a little team with me. I have a woodworking shop back in the Caribbean. And God gave me this vision to build rustic woodwork pieces. Because within my environment, there's nobody that specializes in rustic creation. So you have all the cheap plywood stuff and all the synthetic wood stuff everywhere. Now, but custom-made furniture from hardwood, that rare. So the Lord gave me a little strategy. Here's what. You can enter the market by creating this unique product that is in demand but is not in available supply. So I have entered into a high place in the business realm. So I started building little stuff, little boxes and little frames. Now I'm doing living room sets, patio sets, furniture pieces, big tables. And here's what's happening. So I take these pieces and I put it in a high place. Everybody say the high place. It's on the market. I don't just put it on and wish that people like, no, don't be cheap. Hey, boost your stuff. Take your content and boost it. Listen, everybody say payload. I want to see when I come back here that all kinds of businesses are taking risks and stepping into the marketplace and affecting high places because it's working for me. This is not theory now. This is what paid for me to come here. Hear my heart. So I'm putting this stuff, I'm building my stuff. Everybody here can go and check it online to see if I'm lying. Rustique-collection.com.tt or whatever. Rustique.collection. It's on Instagram. I put this stuff out there and I boost it to certain regions. Strategic marketing. I know where the people with the budget live and I target those areas. Responses start to come in. Inquiries start to come in. How much for this? How much for that? Can I order this? Can you make this for me? Oh, wow. You do wonderful work. Love, love, love. Heart, heart, heart. Amazing job. Oh, thank you. Dave, can you come to my place? Can you come redesign my house? Before you know it, I'm in all kind of rich houses all over the country. And I'm serious. So what do I do? Okay, let's push the envelope a little bit. So they like me. Oh, they like the product. Wonderful. Let's advertise to the region. Let's widen our reach. So I widen the reach of my boost. You know what I'm talking about, boosting, right? Who don't know about boosting? We need a seminar on social media here, right? So everybody can understand how this thing really works. So I widen my reach from just Trinidad and Tobago to strategic islands in the Caribbean, Antigua, Dominica, Jamaica, Guyana has an oil boom happening right now. And all of a sudden, I have responses from the region, people placing orders. I was testing the market, and I have to hold my head because I don't even have the internal capacity to provide for the level of demand that reaches way beyond my waters. I then have to coordinate shipping, packaging, duty-free this, that, clearing goods, somebody on the ground, an agent. A whole world just opened up that requires an industry to support. An entire operation, and God has given dreams regarding these things. Everybody say high places. So there's a vacancy in the business arena for that specific product that has given me access to pull resources and have access to people's lives. Practical. One of the last projects that I worked on before I got here was a piece of furniture for one of the most influential entertainers in the whole of the Caribbean. His mother called me and said, I want you to do a piece. And I walked into this guy's house. I have to be careful of what I say. And I saw influencers in the house that are not kingdom. But guess what? Kingdom walked into the place. Amen? Now, how would I have had access to there? What was the route? I was building furniture. I was delivering what was built. God provided the access. I reach. And you know, once I'm inside, blah, 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 blah. Hallelujah. The presence of God. Please. Be something. Bring some change. Because we're not doing this for money. We're doing this for access. We're doing this for transformation. Because whether we understand it fully or not, the environment is waiting for us to arrive. It's waiting for us to get there. So while I'm there thinking about how to penetrate and have access to the kingdom and all of that, I'm talking to now the Manufacturing Association of the country. They made me a member. So I'm a little manufacturing outfit, but now I have national membership. So the people that I'm in association with are people that are significant in the industry, that now on my shoulder, they go in and they're checking out my product, and now I have to watch it because somebody with bigger money could say, yo, let's take this man out of the industry. Let's capitalize his business. So as you go higher, God needs to say, hey, let's develop strategy around him. So in the context of a kingdom community, here's what happens in a case like that. People, to surround Dave. Let's raise capital. Let's outfit a building. Let's grow this thing. Let's own this industry. Because connected to this little industry is access to something that cannot be done alone. Y'all understand what we're talking about? So what we're talking about now is what I call, and this is the operational strategy for the city. So as we sit down as a community and we begin to talk about what's available for us, how are we going to penetrate, and we change the nature of our conversation. The nature of our conversation is not, oh, God bless me and this man. Oh, God, this problem. You know what? God gonna fix your problem as you engage in his assignment. God gonna fix your finances as you take care of his business. He gonna fix your finances. He gonna establish you. What's your name, son? Yeah. Nathan, God is gonna fix your finances. He's gonna arrange it. Submit to him, and he will arrange your path for you. And he will blow your mind with where you could go. Because you're a man of access. You could get into places that other people can't get into, because that's just the nature of what God has put on your life. And when we begin to identify the type of access that rests on some of those that are here, we could build vision around them. We could build strategy around them. We could say, TikTok girl, we have work for you to do. I don't know nothing about TikTok. To get there. Amen. Y'all following me? So we understanding what we call high places, operational strategy. Next slide. Let's go. 4. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. As for him who lacks understanding, she says to him, whoever is simple, let him turn in here. The house of wisdom focuses on the transformation of the people. It's simple, but let's move you from simplicity. They do not focus on the wise. Watch this. They research the shape and target the message to relevant language, to those that are open-minded and in need of direction and ready to receive their wisdom. Who we are engaging are those that want what we have. We are not here to force anything on anybody. That's not how the kingdom works. There is a demand in the spirit for Christ in us. You don't need to force Jesus on anyone. Jesus just needs to show up and people will say, I want him. The pressure is not on you to perform, but it's to understand how to shape our message, the way we communicate, to be more strategic in how we communicate, to deliver Christ to them, how to present Christ to them. Whoever is simple, Olya, let me show you how it works. Come here. Come and learn from us. Come and glean from our wisdom. Your life messed up. You don't know how to do anything. We're going to show you how to do things with your life. Young people, you all don't understand careers. You don't understand that you live your life from calling and not from opportunity. That's a message I had to teach my son. Don't try to live from opportunity. Live from divine design. Build your life according to the nature that God has put on the inside, your strengths, your gifts, your capacities. Learn that, discover that, and pursue that. Not because an opportunity opens up means it's the way to go. You have to teach that stuff. You have to build a culture that says it is important for us to discover who God has made us to be and build based on that. And that message needs to go out. This thing about self-improvement, we are not about self-improvement. We are about discovery of call and obedience and wisdom in agreeing with call. And that's where grace flows. You're not just trying to create empty opportunity. You're trying to follow what God wants. That's the paradigm that we come from. Because God is the one who has the plan. Who's building the house? God is building the house. And we are just leaning into what God is doing. We're not trying to invent anything. We're just real good listeners. That's our skill set. We're talented at listening. Because when you apply obedience to listening, you just get productivity and progress. That's your secret for success. Amen? Well, let the word of God minister to each and every one of us at a personal level. God, how do I need to arrange my life? What kind of questions I need to start to ask? Who do I need to talk to help me understand what God has put on the inside? Those are the questions that I want to see arising on the inside. You're arranging the table today. They are not involved in a mission of debate. You know, there are some Christians that feel that evangelism and outward work is about challenging the system. Jesus didn't go out there to try to challenge anything, you know. He was there to provide solutions. He was there as relief. He wasn't there to self-justify. By the way, let me prove to you all I'm the Christ. That wasn't the nature of his frequency. The nature of his frequency was, I am self-assured. Let me show you who I am. I don't heal. I am healing. The nature of the message is, meet me. I am the answer to all of your needs. And that's who we are, collectively. We are the answer to this environment. The fact that God has called us here means that we are an answer to some question out there. And that's the nature of our focus. We're not trying to debate or prove ourselves. Christ does not need to prove himself. He has already done that on the cross. He has already redeemed the whole world. They just don't know it yet. He didn't just die for you and me. He died for everybody. The grace of God is spread abroad. Everybody has access to Christ. They just don't know it yet. That's the gospel. The gospel of the kingdom is, come on, John 3:16, let's hear it. Everybody. He so all of who? That he gave what? That what? Whosoever. Whosoever is everybody. It's everybody. But the only way for us to understand the whosoever is we need to go and check. Hey, are you a whosoever? You believe? You believe? Amen. Let's go. Let's walk together. It's basically a sound that we make that those that believe begin to respond to. But you need to go out there and make the sound. We need to go out there and touch lives. And when we begin to do that, Christ in us becomes attractive to them and they begin to move towards him. That's our job. Amen? Next slide. Apostolic prophetic servants of the house proclaim a relevant message and understand how to navigate the high places of influence that bring about transformation. A side note, those that are pursued also come from the high places. If you go into the high places and we're making noise in the high places, we're sounding and we're declaring in the high place, what God is going to get is people who are located there. So part of the strategy of a house of wisdom is we're after people of high places. We have patterns in scripture. Cornelius. When you touch Cornelius, get what happened? The whole house came. We know that in scripture. We touch Cornelius and the whole house came. This is an ancient truth that just doesn't change. It's still in the New Testament. It's right there in scripture. Next slide. The effective building of the house is in the success of servants delivering a message of upgraded life. Not condemnation. Non-exclusivity. Relationship alignment. This is the nature of our message. We're going to take time to go through this in detail on Wednesday. I just want to release it in general. Targeting and discernment. Increase. Our message is not decrease, it's increase. The fear and reverence of the Lord is part of our message. Because do you know that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom? We deliver that. We deliver an awareness of the fear of God to our environment. Our politicians begin to hear our message and understand our value and begin to fear the Lord. And salvation and transformation. I want us to always, always, always keep, especially as apostolic people, that built into our message is always the message of salvation. You see, we're good at the apostolic stuff. We heard about Reformation and blah, blah, blah. Wonderful. You see, salvation, that real. People still need to get saved. We need baptisms. We need immersion and baptizing in the Spirit. We need all of that stuff. That's important. We must never drift from those things in our message. And I'm just admonishing. I know that it is here, but it's an encouragement, not just to those here, but those online, that those key components are critically relevant to ensuring that our message is a balanced one. Amen? Next slide. Proverbs 7. They do not focus on the unwilling and the contentious. Listen. He who corrects a scoffer brings shame to himself. I'm not here to argue with anybody. This stuff works. If you don't believe it, have a nice day. I'm shaking the dust on my feet and moving on. Anytime this house begins to be pushed into a squabble of issues, we've lost sight of the frequency of our communication. We're not into contention. We're into agreement and love. That's who we are. Next slide. to bring this to a close. Just going to spend a couple of time, a little 5 minutes just talking about folly. Houses of folly are easily identified by its emphasis on singular leadership. A foolish woman is clamorous. She is simple and she knows nothing. Wisdom has built a house. She has hewn out what? 7 pillars. But guess what? We're talking about the same contrasting house. A foolish woman is clamorous. She's simple and she doesn't know anything. You're making noise, but you're not saying anything. You're doing stuff, but you're not effective. You're talking a good talk, but the city's still in a mess. That's what that is. Foolish woman, clamorous, noisy, activity, no spirit, no penetration. Void of strategy, clarity, and a suitable structure and corporate strength. Where's her company? The house is defined by her. One person. Everywhere you look in this house, it's just one person representing the whole house. No shared values. No training. Nobody being deployed. Everybody just coming, showing up on a Sunday, have fun, and then go back home. Because a performance was had by the person at the top. That's a foolish house. The city don't get transformed by that. Void of strategy. Ineffective in releasing life. Their words are noise of distraction for the undiscerning. Next slide. The house of wisdom operates within a competitive environment with the house of folly and seeks to mock the message of true transformation without Christ. Listen, we can't have any true transformation without Christ. At the very core, on the high places, folly also calls from the high places. Y'all notice? It is God's strategy that wisdom speaks on the high place. But folly say, all right, that looked like a good idea. Let me go there too. So this is a space that has an adversary within it. It's called folly operating in the same space. Proverbs 9:14. For she sits at the door of a house on the seat of the high places of the city to call those who pass by, who go straight on their way. No sending. Folly is sitting at the door. But the house of wisdom, she's sending maidens. You all see the contrast there? Don't let folly components settle into the house. It will break our effectiveness. Right there. They are built on a strategy of opportunity. Somebody passing by, hey, look at chance. And misdirection of the undiscerning, and they have no prophetic insight. Houses are just, let's set up a little meeting and see who come. You set up a meeting and you see who comes. No, that's not the house of wisdom. That's the house of folly. That's not who we are. We don't just set up and sit down by the door. That's not it. Training, we deploy and we arrange the table, sending out maidens, and we're being strategic, our language is right, and we're just representing Jesus. That's all we need to do. And watch the growth and development that comes. Give me one more. Almost there. The house of folly is lazy. Everybody say lazy. Let that word not be your friend in the sea. Right? Their servants are not trained to be sent and resort in strategies of prophetic seduction. Nice words, boy. Deception, misdirection, exploitation, watered down truth. If you continue to read through, you realize that there are too many places that prioritize on all the theatrics to attract people to the house. It's a show that they use to hook people. They don't connect them to functionality and service and representation. They don't have apostolic characteristics.
built into them. And they ultimately function as a house of death. Because the life of Christ is not flowing through them into the lives of others. Next slide. This is the conclusion. And we have some prayer. I want to pray and just believe God to do some stuff in here today. Amen? Conclusion. The church that Jesus is building, the gates of hell cannot prevail again. Once we build right, Satan has no foothold. That's the promise. All right? Gate Ministries, Durban Central, is called to be a house of wisdom. Everybody say a house of wisdom. Its pillars of community, love, and prayer express the kingdom through the mixture of the prophetic and the apostolic. As servants of the Lord Jesus Christ, we live in his house according to his divine order. All of us allow ourselves to be placed in the right space for God to use us by the Spirit and carry an unapologetic message of transformation to every high place to which we are called. Everybody say, every high place. And that's where we're going to end today. We're going to touch the high places of the city. That's why God has called us. That's why we are gate. We are gate to be deployed, be trained, to become relevant to environment. To just touch the lives of those that need us the most. We're going to just spend some time just believing God and just declaring over the city and declaring over the house and just releasing the capacity to become a house of wisdom. Do we see the complete picture? And this is where we are moving. This is where we are journeying towards. This is where we are moving. There are key components that's going to affect our decisions and how we lean our hearts into this process. Because this is something that we have to be built into. Wisdom as built. Everybody say built. And building takes work, takes thought, it takes action, it takes strategy, planning. But we'll get there. And when we get there, the Shebas will come. The resources will come. The reputation will grow. And God will accomplish everything that he has to accomplish for this house. Amen? Let's just stand. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, no, he plays. Yeah. You stay with me. thank you, God. This is a moment. It wasn't too rough, huh? It wasn't too rough? Good. Let's take encouragement. We're journeying somewhere, and God has set our course. It's good to know that we have a destination in mind. That we're not just drifting. We're not making stuff up along the way. That's not the nature of what God is doing here. He has given us his word, and we submit to it. We agree with it, and we rejoice for it. I just thank God for sight of this, because it causes me to see you more accurately. It causes me to recognize what has been deposited here. My sight was for you today. That's the reason why I saw what I saw. Because it is who Christ has made you to be. And we are going to get to what God wants. We are going to get there. This is a season for the maidens to rise up. And I would like all of the young people, the people that know that they have something on the inside that they know that they need to offer to God in this season. Come forth. You know that you have a call on your life. You have a burning desire to be sent, be placed, to be deployed. Come. We need divine arrangement. We need God to set each and every one of you all in the right space that God has planned for you.
We need to get his mind, his will, and we need to get training. We need the stirring of the gifts. The Apostle Paul talked about this often. That Timothy, stir up the gift that is in you. And this morning we're going to stir the gift. We're going to release gifting, capacity, and a destiny. Thank you. Like you right there. This is a season for each and every one of us to be activated in a new way. For us to understand the place that God has placed us is an accurate place. He's building us into the house of wisdom. We are part of the building. We are critical to its structure. And we understand that the mandate that rests upon the house rests upon us collectively. Everybody say collectively. We embrace this new season. And we are grateful for what God will do. Our hearts yearn for the city. So before I pray for you all, I want us all to pray for the city. Because it is from this place that Jesus moved. The compassion that he had for the city is what caused the miracles to flow. Let's just pray.
Would you lift your hands to the Lord? Amen. Psalm 144 and verse 12 says that may our young men be like tender plants grown up in their youth, and may our daughters be like carved pillars.
Hallelujah.
Set to adorn a palace. And I want to pray that blessing over you. This is a significant moment for all of you. And you're responding to the call of the Lord. Thus says the Lord to you, that you will become pillars in the house of the Lord that will affect cities. Carved pillars, shaped. Not just to adorn the temple, but it'll be highly functional. But the impact will be citywide. I want you to break any parochial, limited mindset you might have, or any preconceived notion of your future. Because God's about to expand it. God's about to take the limits off and give you a view and a peephole into the vast spaces that you need to occupy.
Yes.
So lift your hands to the Lord. Father, we just bring our city before you.
Hallelujah.
We bring Durban before you. And you've called us to be a House Gate Ministries Durban Central. You've given us centrality of the city. You've positioned us here. And God, I pray, oh God, that this city would bear forth and bring forth the prophetic mandate that you've always had in store for it.
Yes.
We've known this city to be the birthing spot, this Natal, this Natalia, this natal context as a womb to birth forth purpose in not just affecting this country, but affecting the nations of the earth. We recall many years back how the apostolic was birthed here and exported to the nations of the earth.
Yes.
And Father, I sense the profundity of a similar moment in Christ as we stand on this dawning of a new era for the city. And even though some of us might not see our relevance for the hugeness of the task that awaits us in how you're going to impact the city, Father, I ask, oh God, that you'd break the limitations of our thinking even now.
Hallelujah.
I ask in the name of Jesus, oh God, that today becomes a new birthing place and season of purpose, of mandate, of responsibility that you place upon our shoulders.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, O God, that all laziness and lethargy and indifference is broken in the name of the Lord Jesus. I pray, O God, that we would see and understand purpose and know what God has called us to. In the name of Jesus, I release an industry, I release a diligence, I release a pro-creativity, a creativity upon every single one in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we lift up holy hands. Come on, lift those hands. We lift up holy hands without wrath or doubt, and we receive instruction. We receive impartation. We receive enablement. We receive impartation. of your heart and your power. Not just your heart.
Yes, yes.
Not just your heart, but Father, your enablement. Mm. Resource us because you send us.
Hallelujah.
Resource.
Resource,
bulk capacity for the command. I know that you don't only
Hallelujah.
Command, but you also capacitate.
Hallelujah.
So Father, I pray that you would capacitate yes. these. Build strongly as reservoir of grace, a reservoir of strength
Hallelujah.
Into every single person, I pray. In the mighty name of Jesus,
yes,
let your power flow now, God.
Hallelujah.
Let your anointing flow. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father, for your goodness and for your grace upon Nathan's life. Thank
Hallelujah.
You, Father, in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you that Faneli will be a strategic dietitian in his field, Father, that he will not only prescribe and tailor-make diets for natural consumption, but Father, he will literally furnish tables spiritually for men to be resourced with grace
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Father God, we just continue to declare that we are journeying with you. Father God, that we are standing behind you, O God. That you are leading us, O God. That you are directing and changing and taking us somewhere. Father God, we ask for the grace to journey with you, O God. Father God, give us the grace to walk alongside you, O God. And to receive of you that which you are pouring out. That which you are releasing in this hour. Cause us to Rebo skaraba sekerebe kitirebe kitarabakate. Hallelujah. Rebo skaraba sandaraba kitirebe kitir. We thank you, God, that you are in this place. Daraba sekerebe kitir. Shebo staraba kitaraba sekerebe kitarabakita. Each and every one of us, oh God, we position our hearts, oh God. Shebo ski. We stir every spirit even right now. We stir up the gifts that lay dormant in the house. And we call them to life right now. We say every dead thing arise. Every dead thing be resurrected right now. Every lost dream come to life right now. Every lost vision come to life right now. Every lost sight come to life right now. Every lost sight come to life right now. Every blind place, we declare light coming right now. We declare new dreams. We declare new visions. We declare dreams and visions coming to the people of God. We declare, oh God, a release of capacity in this house. Father God, we declare wholeness to contain that which you want to pour in. And we declare this to be a season of pouring, a season of release, a season of dissension. Lord God, let this be the house that is called Bethel, oh God. Let there be ascension. Let there be dissension. Let there be a fresh interaction in heaven, oh God. Shebo shenebe salabaketa rabaketa. Bo shondo. Cause there to be an explosion from this place. Pour out your spirit, oh God, upon all flesh. And cause your sons to prophesy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Not by might, not by power, by your spirit, mighty God. Shebo serebe, rebo staraba sekarabaye, shobo ro robo sodo robo skerebe. Yes, oh God, do it for the city, oh God. Do it for your namesake, oh God. Cause each and every one of us to be duly aligned according to your purpose. Robo starabasende, reba satarabayande. Fresh anointing, oh God, upon the worship. Let your presence descend in the worship, oh God, as your servants call upon your name. Let this be a place of watering and restoration, a place of infilling, so that we can pour out. A place of soaking up so that we can release. Father God, let your name be lifted up in this place. Everybody lift your hands. Lift your hands. This is a moment to give God praise. Father God, we honor you today. You are our mighty King. You are our sovereign God. We magnify your name today. We say, arise, O God. Let your enemies be scattered. Let they that hate you flee before you. Arise in our midst, O God, as a mighty man of war. Lion of the tribe of Judah. Roar from this place. Let your sound be heard from this place. Let the goodness of mercy flow from this place. Let this be a house of health, healing, and wholeness. Let this be a house of representation, patterns, prototypes, and let the word of God live in our lives. Let the word become flesh today. Signs and wonders follow the word. And we give you praise. We give you honor. Submit our lives to you afresh. Anybody that needs to recommit their lives to Christ, come forward now. Anybody's lives are not aligned right, let's stand in agreement. Let's make this moment. Let's suck everything out of it. We can return to our seats and just let those that want to be realigned back to right standing come forward. We'll just agree and just trust God. There's no shame in this house. Let your will be done, O God. Even in me, let your will be done. Everybody, put your hands on your chest. They do it in me. Create in me a clean heart. And renew a right spirit within me. Father God, we repent corporately for our sins, for our shortcomings. Even I, O God, I stand first and I repent first. But I say, Lord God, your grace is sufficient. And in Christ, there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. Continue your work deep in our hearts today. Rebuild and restore and recalibrate. This is a house of forgiveness. There is no condemnation here. We are all journeying towards Christ together. Father God, we release every condemnation that seeks to live in this place. We release broken hearts today. We cast off frustrations today. We release courage. Courage to repent and to forgive. And to receive the forgiveness of God. I cast off every burden of self-doubt and self-condemnation from this place. We have not yet arrived, but we are journeying with Christ. And we will journey together. We honor you for your goodness, Lord Jesus. You know us exactly where we are. The areas where we struggle. The areas where I struggle, you know, oh God. But today we lay it all at your feet. And we give thanks. And we rejoice in your goodness. We thank you for this eternal salvation that knows no bounds, that touches every brokenheartedness. And Lord, because you have done it for me, you can do it for this city. Because you've forgiven me, oh God, we forgive the leaders of this nation for wrongdoing, for selfishness, for corruption. We forgive our leaders even right now. And we stand in the gap for Durban right now. And we say this is a day of restoration to our city. This is a day of forgiveness for those that have been abandoned and left. We say we got your back. And we are coming to get you. We thank you, Lord God, that your love was poured out for each and every one of us. And we thank you for that which you're doing in this hour. What you're establishing. Hallelujah. Come, brother. Come. Hallelujah. Is that your name? Mark, I thank you for coming. I thank you for being part of who we are. I thank you for taking a stand. I hear the Lord say, pillar. This is a season of just creating greater functionality for you. For opening new doors to your life. Have an open heart to take more weight. To commit your family to releasing you to do more for the kingdom. I thank you for the infectious spirit that rests upon this man. I thank you that you shaped him. You took your time to shape him through adversity. Behind that smile, Christ is formed on the inside. I thank you that this is a day of light for him, a day of showcase for him, a day of presentation, a day of relief. The Lord is calling you to function, not just within the house, but out of the house, to be sanctioned by the house, to go with the grace of the house, to declare his word, to preach, to declare, to align, to bring alignment, to bring alignment, to bring alignment. You're a man of alignment. Bring alignment. Release alignment to the places that I will send you. Straighten things that are crooked. Create highways in the lives of men that have access direct to me. Hallelujah. Prophesy, brother. Release prophetic capacity upon him even right now. Feel the gift of prophecy in him. We declare new utterance. New utterance. Utterance. New capacity to hear. New capacity. New capacity to hear. New capacity. Open the eyes of his understanding. And release your spirit of prophecy into his life. Thank you, Lord God. God abos. Plain brother. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Karabasa Karabaki. Come. Hallelujah. Dere Besike. Hallelujah. The meaning? Brittany. Thank God for Brittany. Brittany, I hear the Lord saying, great schooling. Your academic journey isn't done. There's a lot in that direction that God wants to take you in. If you were thinking, oh, I had enough, say no. Release courage and strength in the academic world. Your success in the academic world will have onlookers. I thank you for that which you will accomplish in Christ, in the realm of education. Release grace. Hallelujah. Oh God, I see grace coming upon you right now. Don't even be afraid of the medical field. Don't be afraid of the medical field. Go for it. Go for it. Hallelujah. Oh, grace on my sister. Let your light shine upon her right now. Fresh capacity coming. Where you thought you wasn't able, God gonna make you able. What you thought you couldn't do, God said, I know you could do it. And let your light shine. And the light is Christ. Let your grace come upon her even right now. Father God, change the configuration of our inside. Enlarge our insides, oh God. To receive you, I see your prayer life going to another level. Your declaration, your utterances, the things that flow out of your mouth, breaking things and shattering things. Listen, let that voice be heard. Be first in prayer meetings and let that thing just roar from your life. I pray that space get created for you. For the utterances that God would raise up on the inside to come out. And we'll celebrate when we see it together. Amen? We'll celebrate it with you. We'll rejoice with you. Your success will be our success. We'll share in this together, church. When Brittany rises, we all rise with her. Preserve her life, the integrity of her walk. We honor you today for what you're going to do in her life. In Jesus' name. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Father. How's it go? I messed up. Hallelujah.
Say we share. We share and we take corporate responsibility. Amen. So I surrender. I surrender. I surrender. Lord, I surrender my life. I give it all to you. My king, be my heir.
We bow before